Welcome, and thank you for joining us for the fifth installment of Indisposable Structures of Support after the ADA. Before we begin, a quick note about access and engagement options during the program. Tonight's event includes American Sign Language interpretation provided by Sign Nexus and live closed captioning provided by Vitech. Our ASL interpreters are Gloria Vargas and Michael Barrios. To access live closed captions, click the closed captions button at the bottom of your screen. Please use the Q&A and chat functions at the bottom of your screen to share your questions, comments, or reactions. If you have any technical questions or issues during the event, please email av@fordfoundation.org. For the best viewing experience, please set your view to gallery mode, which can be found at the top right-hand corner of your Zoom screen. Thank you. Our program will begin shortly. Good evening. My name is Lisa Kim, and I have the great honor of serving as the inaugural director of the Ford Foundation Gallery. I am a middle-aged Korean-American woman with shoulder-length straight black hair. I am wearing large framed pink glasses, a black V-neck top, and behind me is a bookcase and my son's bunk bed. I'm coming to you from the unceded territory of the Mohicans and Munsee Lenape, on land that was seized through war, disease, and forcible relocation by European colonizers. This is the fifth installment of our year-long series of new project commissions and artist collaborations conceived by curators Jessica A. Cooley and Anne M. Fox, who are behind the scenes with us today. Please be sure to explore the gallery website pages to learn more about our curators' vision for this exhibition and watch videos of our past events. Through Zoom, we've traveled to Southern Ecuador, Madison, Wisconsin, Berlin, and London. And tonight we gather from across the country, coast to coast. We are at the halfway point of our 8-chapter series for Indisposable. Our first installment contemplated questions about rest and care, about the commodification of bodies, labor, and land. And now, as we tentatively emerge from a time of global pandemic, we begin to mourn. Tonight's event was brilliantly conceived by Jill Casid, and our remaining chapters will foreground how mourning can shape activism, reach across historical periods, reclaim knowledge, and be a shared source of comfort as well as a call to action. On screen is that better? Okay, sorry about that. If I had a sound issue. On screen is our roadmap for the evening. We have a packed 70 minutes for you today, and we encourage you to enjoy the event in a manner that is comfortable for you. The subject matter being discussed tonight includes some language and references to events, images, recent and not so recent history that some may have a visceral reaction to. Please know that the event is being recorded and we will share the video on our website after the event so you may revisit it at another time. Quick note about our esteemed panelists tonight. We will refrain from listing everyone's accomplishments and achievements here as that would easily take the full hour. Their bios may be found on our website. So without further ado, we are pleased to begin our event, Melancholy as Medium, with a transmission sent to us from Fierce Pussy.
Dearest beings of 2021, we are trans-echoing our transmission across time. In 2020, there was a rupture.
Our trans scholars, translators, and transcribers continue to transmonitor your wave. We get frequency from whales, dolphins, and corvids. Singing, dancing, and moving bodies amplify your signal. We hear you call the names of your dead. We mourn with you.
There is a breach in your planetary atmosphere. Why do so many of your people suffer from hunger and dis-ease?
We are unable to translate the phrase for profit. What does this mean?
We note your medical texts and millennia of acupuncture and healing, but cannot decipher the intention in eligibility, insurance, coverage. Do you not care for all your peoples?
We transform adoration for many of your transistors.
Yoko Ono.
Patti Smith. Bell Hooks.
James Baldwin.
David Bowie.
Sitting Bull.
Justin Vivian Bond.
Maria Callas.
Buffy St. Marie.
Chantel Ackerman.
Sylvester.
Linda Nochlin.
Audre Lorde.
Dr. Mathilde Krim.
Celestial Nina Simone.
And the flame, Angela Davis.
Man, woman, he, she, can you translate for us, we, together? What happens in the glorious middle?
Why does the pigmentation of the outer layer of the epidermis bestow privileges and deny rights? In our commons, variation in the spectrum is simply a beauty to behold.
Can you explain the following words? Kike, faggot, chink, nigger, bitch.
You seem to delight in explosions and shattering of bodies. Often your beings are dressed in uniform garb. Is this sport? Is this what you call theater? There is blood and screaming. People buried in sharded metal and stone, lying still and lifeless. Do you kill each other?
What is police?
Is it true that many of your people have no homes? Why do any of your beings live in cages? Do you still engage in the practice of slavery?
Cooperation and corporation, do they mean the same thing?
What is this word, rape? What happened to your air, your water, and what's up with your garbage?
In your earlier waves, you described a civil rights movement. We know you call yourselves human. Is there an E on the end of that?
This word, border, what does it mean? Also, segregation, password, marriage, country, refugee, money. What are keys?
We are transbegoggled. Our wisest trans scholars, transcestors, witches, and librarians are unable to untangle these questions. Do you need assistance? We are here to help. Give us a sign.
We get exceptionally clear reception of Agnes Martin, David Hammonds, Ray Kawakubo, Tony Fair, Prince, Rosie Lee Tompkins, AOC, Joni Mitchell, Hilma af Klint, Notorious RBG, B.I.G., the Queen of Soul, late Manet and all the Davids.
We transceive a loud and growing hum from those you call she. Their ascendancy is transpiring.
After our transplendent overcome, we chose to build an egalitarian society and work in symbiosis with the planet.
Do your people hope and dream for transformation? We have transversed the universe and found no other planet Earth like yours. We, the beings of the transplendency, are deeply concerned. We gather you do not swim the time stream. We can share our time routes if you would like to visit. You are most welcome.
Please send Fierce Pussy to us. They're from the future. We want to dance with them.
In the wild, we offer our words to live by. Transition.
Transmission.
Transformation. Transmigration.
Transmutation.
Transgression.
Transspontaneity.
Transfinity. Transcendence.
Transplendence.
Your descendants in the free state of the transplendency.
In 1961, without Fannie Lou Hammer's knowledge or consent, she was given a hysterectomy while in the hospital for minor surgery, a procedure so common it was known as a Mississippi appendectomy, and this poem is for her. Honey, doused anger what you took, draws blood if you not careful. I scream in whispers, and hives of bees pour out my mouth. For what is missing? The buzzing never done stopped across cotton fields of hardened white buds, where there were once flowers that toughened up tender hands. In that space where there once was, a universe is passing. Me like cotton, when cotton is ready to be picked, the flowers wilt and fall, leaving nothing but a hard brown bowl that cracks open its shell to soft white fluff. This, my, our body becomes rough like the roots of hydrangea trees, filled with gnats and fruit flies, the sign of a devil nearby. Spiny talons, protected dollops of white, dewy cotton, a space where love will never grow. Where you, I, never grow. This, my, our body, swollen from the emptiness. In that space, a universe is passing. 1961 becomes now. And like my fingers reaching into the cotton bowl, the gnarled, knotty fists reaching backward into the new of miss, is, sip, e, pound, my, are this spirit down into the hollow you took, pinched like Mississippi cotton. You took the cotton twisting up inside me, but I wasn't ready. I was not. I was to be picked like flowers. Bees pour out my mouth to suckle at the breasts of lilacs and black-eyed Susans, nibbling first at one, then at another. In this flower garden, I could taste the afterbirth of the loss. Like a laying on of the hands, Fannie Lou Hammer hands, not doctors that pinch cotton from black, brown, yellow bodies. Bodies free from bondage, but still for profit, came out missing. What you know about eyes flecked with sprinkles of joy, teared, missing the small kisses falling on my neck like a breeze heavy with ocean. Instead of babies, I birthed my anger, half carried and half dragged my body from barren lands, tubes tied like the roots of oaks and pines, sisters, mothers, wives, trying to make something from this wood. My name is Heather Lynn Johnson. I am a poet and an artist resting on unceded land and territory of the Lenape. I have a high top fade that is a messy twist. My skin is the color of dark chocolate in Caribbean castles and coffee fields. I'm wearing a dark blue blazer, a black tank top, and a silver chain in my studio apartment with red heart lights behind me under a large photograph of an 8-year-old black girl over my right shoulder and a large photograph of a barren forest over my left shoulder. I am honored to be your host tonight for Indisposable, Structures of Support After the ADA, Chapter 5, Melancholy as Medium. And now I would like to introduce the collective, What Would an HIV Doula Do?
Hello, my name is Pato Hebert. I'm a bald person, light-skinned in a light blue guayabera, a COVID long hauler sick since March 2020, calling from Tongva Land here in Los Angeles.
Hello, my name is Abdul-Aliy Muhammad. I'm on Lenape land in Philadelphia. And I have a pink shirt on that says Rest in Power, Dominique Remy Fells, a Black trans woman who was murdered in Philadelphia a year ago today. I am dark skinned. I have short, tightly curled hair. I have a mustache and a beard. And behind me is my messy bed that has pink sheets. And also behind me, you'll see a bookshelf full of my library.
It's an honor to be here with you and to share the work of What Would an HIV Doula Do?, which is our collective of dozens of doulas and activists and organizers, writers, and artists. Abdul-Aliy and I are going to share screen grabs and read from the introduction of a zine that the collective created last year as part of the uprising.
We want to celebrate Ted Kerr, who doulas the doulas, designer Virgil Taylor, all of the contributors, and the One Archive Foundation for so much strategy, solidarity, and support. October 2nd, 2020. We understand a doula to be someone who holds space for others during times of transition. In our rage and resourcefulness, our hope and our hurting, our conviction and our care, we hold space for the transition that an uprising might be.
We can also safeguard and shepherd seeds, helping to cultivate conditions for change. A doula minds demands and dangers, needs, and the nascent. A doula asks. A doula listens. A doula can be quiet. A doula can scream. Doulas can use our hands, networks, traditions, skills, phone chargers, stimulus checks, leftovers, voice. A doula can lose their voice, happily hoarse with the recourse of call and response. A doula can sing, and a song can doula you through transitions.
A doula can give water and masks, Zoom massages, and knowing nods, harm-reduced healing touch, delivered meals and transferred coin, a couch. A doula can be scared, sick, skeptical, believing, embarrassed, ecstatic, evolving, humbled, joyful, spent, rejuvenated, determined, deliberate, irreverent, innovative, interconnected. A doula recognizes and honors limits. A doula can offer reassurance and rest, replenishment and release. A doula dances with uncertainty, admits to not knowing. A doula is a formulation, a formation, a praxis, an action, an opportunity to give and to grow. Solidarity and love are doulas.
We are also learning that uprisers, and uprisings need to sleep, hydrate, eat, write, shower, shut up, shout, strategize, celebrate, come, cry. An upriser and an uprising might have to make room for maneuvers, tenderness, horror, candor, rupture, indignation, revelation, imagination. We also know from our own experience that not everyone can be in the streets or in jail, in public or on camera, yet everyone can contribute in their own unique ways to an uprising. Change has many rhythms, forms, and scales. We can help each other rethink and reshape our shared relationship to resources, our commitment and accountability to mutual care, and our very understanding of power and ourselves.
In the place and time of uprising, one of the things that doulas can ask is, what does an uprising need? And what does this tell us about our roles? The collective, as stated above, understands a doula as someone who holds space during times of transition. And isn't an uprising a series of transitions that begin long before any of us may notice and last long after many of us might stop paying attention? Uprising is a collective process over time that happens because of us, through us, and around us. We want to pause here and ask, what are the limits of doula work? How do we hold space for the fact that an uprising is loud, public, and includes bodies and souls on the line, but can also be private, intimate, internal, and maybe almost unseeable?
Something that is clear is that for an uprising to succeed, demands for better must be taken up at multiple levels, in multiple formations, across time. Doulas have our part to play in this process. As systems die, our collective rage, when shared, can help us to survive until we can get to a place in which together we can dream into existence the world that we want to inhabit. This is why it's important to consider the many ways that we help each other move through the transitions of upheaval.
In rising up, we doulas give and we scheme. We stumble and we dream. We err and we learn. We grind and we churn. We post and we toast. We bawl and sometimes brawl. And through it all, we hold space for one another, as well as those who don't yet know and may never see.
Reversing the primacy of showing over telling, the screen is black and my voice addresses you directly. Seances normally begin with invocations. This is a seance for sensing. Past the ingrained compulsions of ableist, heteropatriarchal racial capitalism. For the soundings of an unhinged mouth, with no door on the howl, the awful shrieking of outraged grief. For the not letting go of the mad love, the radical care for the should have been, will have been thrivings of Black, Indigenous, crip, queer, and trans life. Researchers at the University of Washington's Institute for Health Metrics and Evaluation estimate that the COVID-19 death count worldwide is closer to 7 million, more than double the reported 3.24 million, while the U.S. count is over 900,000, a figure 57% higher than the official count. The difference? Attuning to what statistics calls excess mortality, or deaths in excess of what would normally be expected. Why calculate excess mortality in terms of just this virus, when the HIV/AIDS crisis is hardly over? In the non-reckonings of such estimations, where is the death toll of white supremacy, capital's theft of forest ecologies, militant Zionism, native genocide and dispossession? When it comes to the dead and dying, the regime of calculation persists in underestimating our presence and our power. Not least our rage grief resistance to accepting the throwaway, let-die conditions of the anti-Black, anti-crip, anti-Asian, anti-queer, anti-refugee, anti-femme, anti-trans, necro-normal of settler coloniality. Excess death. The screen remains black. Under the title Reckoning with the Dead, there's an image I refuse to show you. This photograph I am not reproducing was shot in May 2020 at Brooklyn's Sunset Park Pier, when over 20,000 died in less than 2 months, overwhelming the city's inadequate structures of support, from its hospitals to even its morgues. You won't see it here, but be wary of how photographs like this one take up the mantle of the ostensible heroism of facing the unnamed disposable of the COVID-19 pandemic, only to back away from accountability for the warehousing of human life from the nursing home to the prison and the meatpacking plant. Shot from inside the barbed wire fencing that surrounds the monitored South Brooklyn Marine Terminal, converted into a disaster morgue, the photograph takes us right up to one of the rows of refrigerated trailers that form part of a mobile network of over 200. Fitted with racks where the as yet unclaimed COVID-19 dead are stacked 90 to a truck. By the end of December 2020, 530 frozen corpses were still in the limbo of the disaster morgue before eventual internment on Hart Island. Territory of the Siwanoy Nation in Long Island Sound and run by the Department of Corrections since 1868, Hart Island remains the largest mass gravesite in the United States. And may also be the largest cemetery for victims of the AIDS epidemic. About 750 of the unclaimed bodies of those lost to COVID-19 are still warehoused in the refrigerated trucks at the 39th Street Pier before transfer to Hart Island, where 1 in 10 people in New York who died of COVID-19 in 2020 have been buried by Rikers Island prisoners. In its hurry to move us past mourning and replace grief with signs of techno-capitalist resilience, the photograph I refuse to show works hard to quickly usher us away from the lineup of the refrigerator back ends of the parked freezer trucks to a glowing horizon where the Statue of Liberty rises, still standing. Its uplifted arm holding that lamp, which in the photograph's elemental staging acts with the allegorical thud of the literally heavy-handed, as if the mighty woman with a torch, Emma Lazarus named the Mother of Exiles, were the source of the photograph's claim to illumination. The photograph I refuse endeavors to contain death's uncontrollable wildness. By taking recourse to the monumental statue, that infrastructural support of white supremacy used to prop fantasies of sovereignty and exceptionalism, the photograph attempts to make us unsee the real, the ways disaster racial capitalism's logics of disposability create the conditions that make living with more than one virus, COVID-19 and HIV/AIDS, pandemic, and lethal. I'm laying a set of 13 Polaroids on the table before us. The image failures and glitches I am showing you are what emerged from the foiled effort of going out to Sunset Pier, where the only wayfinding for the disaster morgue consisted of no photography signs. I got as far as the guard station. Close enough to see the makeshift sign pointing to the entrance for funeral directors, and get caught by the security guard who barred access. From a distance and mostly from the other side of the ubiquitous fencing, I was curious what might still happen with the old Polaroid SX-70 I brought with me. The 13 I'm laying out before you are, like all Polaroids, fragile originals, vulnerable to the volatilities of the weather. In the material fragility of its contacts, the Polaroids conjure with loss, summoning the uncontrolled chance encounters where material vulnerability meets disposability and something alchemical happens. It was as if the sight repelled the images that are perceptible here only in and with the force of a kind of repulsing interference. In their delicate surface emulsions, what we might still call images are barely, unevenly, incompletely registered, yet thick with the atmosphere and the color of nightmares and dreams. Strange mauves pierced by odd spots, stripes of blue and black punctured by weird holes of brown. Images in passage, less recorded than oozed. Not quite emerging from their developing fluid, that unruly pace that erupts unpredictably, the ectoplasm of what called itself modernity. What if the other side of the image were a portal? What if the seance from the bed of trouble of crip melancholy doesn't end until there's justice, reparation, abolition thriving? In this extractive, throwaway world in which we're made to live our dying on a dying planet, and yet our outraged grief is despised and refused, in the necroscene, which is our planetary scene, we can still sense the otherworldly call of a melancholy strike, of a planetary politics not as usual, that refuses to return to the killing normal. The abolition chorus of a crip melancholy that refuses to let go of our dead, that assembles and keens with the refused grief called otherworldly because it summons and cleaves, cracking us open to the sense of another world that supports the sick, the weak, and the dying we are. After the catastrophes that have already occurred, the genocide and dispossession, the trauma on repeat from Ferguson to Gaza, Minneapolis to Sheikh Jarrah, that we interrupt with that mad sense of justice that strikes with melancholy as medium, not moving on, staying stubbornly attached, summoning that other world with the matter and mattering of the dead and disposable still here, with and within an uncanny us.
Now I would like to introduce the incredibly talented and incomparable poet, artist, activist, and the winner of the 2021 Lambda Literary Award for Lesbian Poetry, Pamela Sneed.
Yay, thank you everybody. Okay, so Jill, that was incredible. Everyone, really, really powerful here. So I am a tall black lesbian, but I'm sitting down, and I have dark brown skin and a shaved head, yellow glasses, and a cowrie shell necklace. And this is Lenape territory. And basically I'm going to read an excerpt from Funeral Diva. I'm not sure where it belongs, but I must insert. There were times when I, the funeral diva, was not always noble. I was traveling while my dear friend, the visual artist Dawn Reed, was dying, and I ran away. We worked together at the Hetrick Martin Institute for Gay and Lesbian Youth. He was an art therapist, and at 23 years old, I ran the after-school program. I met him on a panel first at Harlem Hospital. He was part of the group that existed in the 80s called Black and White Men Together. At that panel, Don carried on his back the baby son he'd adopted with his white partner. This is long before gay people adopting children was common. His son's name was Max, and he was a tiny brown baby Don adored. Later, working at the Institute, Don and I would have many adventures and escapades with baby Max in tow. There was a time, a year or two after Max started walking, he wanted to be a peacock for Halloween. Don, being a gay man, a visual artist, and sudden costume designer, searched day and night for real feathers. He spent all night sewing together Max's costume. There was a time we took baby Max to church, and because Don raised him to be free, Max wandered down the aisle at 3 years old, stood next to the preacher, and did an interpretive interpretation of the preacher's words. The preacher seemed annoyed, but Don, a proud parent, smiled the whole time. I remember our offices at the Institute, located on the West Side Highway, across from the Hudson River. There was lots of sunlight. We were in formation. We were making ourselves. While others were dying around us, Don was in denial about HIV/AIDS. We never talked about it. Even when he got the telltale pneumonia, the rapid weight loss, and the terrible fear, we never said AIDS. By the time I left the agency, I was traveling as an actor and leaving the next day when I heard Don was in the hospital. I understand he asked for me. I heard his voice in my head asking, "How's Pam?" But my feet were leaden. I couldn't go. I didn't want my last image to be of a man shrunken down to a skeleton. Like the recent survivors of Hurricane Katrina and Maria in Puerto Rico, I was grief-stricken and waterlogged. Maybe this is like scenes from the Holocaust or World War II, omissions you won't find in any history book, but like in concentration camps when stripped to bare essentials, like in a novel popular during the 70s when survivors of a plane crash devoured human flesh, or Margaret Garner, the slave who ran away and murdered her own child rather than see it become a slave, in Toni Morrison's novel, Beloved, she is haunted by the child's ghost, like in Chimamanda Adichie's novel, Half of a Yellow Sun, about the Nigerian Biafran War, a beloved boy character whom we believed in is so corrupted and dehumanized by war, he participates in a gang rape. There's a story I heard in South Africa after the end of apartheid. A boy and his friend rape a girl on the road, they kill her. The boy eventually returns to turn her over and discovers the girl he raped and killed was actually his own sister. A teacher hears this story and she screams out to her classroom appalled, asking, after all Black people have fought and died for, tell me, is this the new South Africa? Like that South African boy, Margaret Garner, the subject of Viktor Frankl's essays about the Holocaust and others, some of us in the AIDS crisis did terrible things to survive. Never made it down the aisles of the hospital wards of Bellevue and St. Vincent's. Couldn't bear shit-stained walls and terrible, wretched smells of death. Some of us couldn't bear the hatred and scornful eyes as we passed the nurse's station, saw doctors and family members who blamed us. Some of us were so grief-soaked and waterlogged, we couldn't take one more step, having seen things and experienced things in our lifetimes that no human being or citizen should. During Hurricane Katrina, I was in Ghana. On television, I saw a tidal wave sweep downstairs and trap a young Black girl. Firefighters yelled through a basement window, "Hold on, baby girl, hold on, just hold on, we're coming." But despite hers and despite their efforts, she drowned. Some of us were noble, we tried, but we couldn't carry anymore and were forced to let go, watched bodies devoured, the very breath and essence stolen, limbs, life support cut off. Some of us went MIA, AWOL, were forced into black market drugs and operations like women in the 60s using cords, wire hangers, and glass to abort in back alleys. Some like Sammy, lover of Michael Brody, father of the Paradise Garage, a beautiful Latino boy with pure soul, ravaged by AIDS, shot himself in the head at point blank range. He couldn't stand what the virus did to him. The shame he felt, like something out of Kafka's Metamorphosis, when a human being is transformed into a bug, we became pariahs, the despised, choosing to wear in defiance badges, gaze in the Holocaust, wore pink triangles, like something out of Poe's Telltale Heart, like in the diary of Anne Frank, we hid beneath floorboards, transforming into monsters or messiahs because, as Audre Lorde declared in her battle with cancer, once having come face to face with death, who might ever have power over us again? Some of us who were witnesses had blinders and bandages ripped off, developed an X-ray vision. Some of us, like survivors of the Japanese internment camps in World War II, having lost everything, developed a new appreciation for life. Some of us, for some of us, snowfall, rain, water, flowers, a book, apple, paintbrushes, papers, pens took on new meaning. Some of us, when we were touched or someone was actually kind, we cried. The only words I have to describe this time were the words written by poet Michael LaSalle, "How to Watch Your Brother Die," in Essex Hemphill, "When My Brother Fell." The only thing that kept us all going were the words of Audre Lorde, Essex, Pat Parker, and Joe Beam. The only thing that freed me from the guilt of not seeing Dawn in the hospital was a story I read years later by Bell Hooks, when she talked about not going to see a grandmother who was dying because she said I was the person who loved her most. When Dawn died, I was on a hilltop outside of Paris. Like a cord cut, I felt the exact moment breath left his body. When I returned home from Paris, I saw Max, who was about 4 years old. We went to a museum together. The next day I called, and Dawn's surviving lover, Steve, reported Max had awakened the next day after we went to the museum and said out loud, after I'd just begun to believe that my friend was dead and gone forever, "Pamela laughs like daddy." Dawn Reed, Rory Buchanan, Craig Harris, David Frechette, Essex Hemphill are just a few. There are countless others. So many wakes and funerals I attended paying tribute to strangers as if each were a family member of my own or a close friend. But the basis of this story could never be for thousands, hundreds of thousands who died. About massive grief remaining unprocessed, blows endured to every industry, fashion, literature, business, performance. It's not about the mysteries, invisible hands, legs, minds, behind things I still think, wear, do. It's not about the martyrs who gave and lost lives so that we now can enjoy freedoms of marriage and protection under laws. It's not about men and women I will never forget, faces publicly streaked with tears, empty caskets carried openly through the streets in protest. It's not about those like Alan Williams, who worked with me at the Lesbian and Gay Community Center, a volunteer who would say every time I saw him, "You're so beautiful." He loved to hear the story of how I, as a little girl, a little Black girl, would go to the hairdresser as a child and ask the hairdresser to make my hair whirl and twirl like the figure skater Dorothy Hamill. "Write that story," he'd say. This is not about Tim Boyd, the sign language interpreter whom I often performed with, who died from AIDS, and his mother, who still grieves. It's not about my friend Dawn Reed, the beautiful collages he made, and the son, lover, and friends he left behind. It's not about Jody from the South, the first white boy whom I ever heard say y'all, and all those gay boys I met and worked with at a restaurant in Boston who disappeared like thousands of bits of paper wind just simply took. Gone, disappeared, like those dissidents of Castro's Cuba. Like the friends and supporters of Allende, this story is not about them. It is not about heroic women, Audre Lorde, June Jordan, Pat Parker, my grandmother, and the cancer they fought. It's not about conspiracies, neglect, nor costumes I wore. It's not about today, where some people can actually live with HIV and AIDS. It's not about those miracle drugs and cocktails, though I do wish could have gotten here just one day. Just one moment. one second sooner. I'm saved just one more. In the words of Schindler, who saved Jews from the Gestapo and bought their freedom, even after he spent his lifetime fortune, he wanted to save more. At the end of that film, he's broken and he cries out as if he's bargaining with God. Please, God, just one more. Just give me one more. Just one more. In my own words, after every semester teaching students, seeing so many grow and change, but wishing my hands could reach and were big enough and I could save just one more. Like Harriet Tubman, after every mission, having rescued over 300 slaves, but said if they only knew that they were slaves, I could have saved so many more. No, this story is not about them. But like a song is sung with all of my soul and blood and is dedicated to one person, one memorial, one funeral, where I did not speak. Thank you.
Wow, that was so beautiful, Pamela. Thank you so much. And I'd like to welcome back all of the panelists tonight. Fierce Pussy and What Would an HIV Doula Do? And Jill. Thank you all for your beautiful, beautiful contributions for the evening. And we're going to start the Q&A portion of the night. And if you guys want to add your questions to the chat, please do. And we'll see if we have time to get to them. All right. So I think the first question I would like to start with is, how do we thrive in a world that does not want us to exist? HIV/AIDS, COVID-19, Black people getting murdered in the streets by police, the rising violence against the AAPI community, the average life expectancy of Black trans women is to the age of 35, and this has been spoon-fed to us as the new normal. We are told to get over it. The cop who killed George Floyd was found guilty, as if that makes up for all the other cops who are killers. And as an artist and a poet, this past year has been crippling for me. And I'm curious, and I'd like to open it up to the panelists now and ask, how do you perceive your role as an artist and writer during this time? And how do you thrive and take care of yourself?
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Heather, for your beautiful facilitation. Pamela. Thank you, Jill. Thank you, Pato. Thanks to the Ford Foundation Gallery. I mean, just thanks to everyone who, to the folks providing ASL interpretation, to the beautiful audience, to our doulas who are on and not on here. I just want to take a moment to appreciate Pamela's poem transmission from Funeral Diva. I'm in Philadelphia, the unceded land of the Lenni Lenape people. I'm in a part of the city called King Sessing. And the Lenni Lenape called this part of the city Chinsessing. And I am, 20 or so blocks away from where Joseph Beam was found dead in an apartment in Center City weeks after he died of AIDS complications. And so when I heard Pamela's words, it made me cry. It made me think of so many beautiful people lost to the structural violence that is HIV. HIV is structural violence. So I want to just take a moment to appreciate that. And to your point, Heather, around the question of what we do, I think we do this. I think we show that collectively we understand that our futures are intertwined. I think we show beautiful visuals like Jill's that unpacks the violence. I think we share beautiful words like Pato's words that are weaved throughout the introduction of the zine, What Would an Uprising Doula Do? I think we contemplate and imagine a world that people don't have to die in the ways that people die now.
Thank you, Abdul-Aliy. Does anybody else want to add to that? It's beautifully said. Jill?
So I just wanted to say first that here I am on the unceded land of the Ho-Chunk Nation, that acknowledging that is not enough without material decolonization, land back, reparation for histories of genocide and dispossession that are the beginnings of what gets claimed as the land of the free. And I am zooming in here only because of accidents of refugee survival. And I should also self-describe that this studio scenario has white walls and lights that are illuminating hair that's black with two very thick white streaks that might now remind of Cruella de Vil, but I think that I hoped it was a little bit more Susan Sontag, and a black leather tie that signals a certain degree of insistence on gender confusing. I am light skinned. I have a history of, well, refusing to do what I'm supposed to do as a survivor of Jewish refugees in the United States, which is to insist that none of us are free until all of us are free, and that settler coloniality, whatever we might say about it, we have no commitment unless we are also committed to a free Palestine. After all of that, would just say very quickly that what I am imagining is exactly what Fierce Pussy, I cannot thank you enough for your transmission. Heather Lynn Johnson, I cannot thank you enough for undoing, redoing the plantation landscape that is still here and which has still not been addressed. Thank you, What Would an HIV Doula Do? I am, as all of us are, gifted by your work on an ongoing basis. And Pamela Sneed's Funeral Diva is a lifeline. That was a very small extract from what is always best delivered by Pamela, to the extent that Zoom can be in person. I can just say that it should be read cover to cover, and that the vision that, and but also sound that I can't let go of is what would happen if we, instead of imagining that and taking the marching orders to get past mourning and just move on with the production orders of heteropatriarchal racial capitalism, that we would make good on the extent to which grief is derived from strike and turned our grief and mourning outward. Imagine holding on to all of those losses to the point of a planetary strike that I can't let go of. And yet it requires beauty and joy, which is a radical joy that can hold together rage, grief, and pleasure, and comfort, which is and healing, which is, I hope, what this evening is also dedicated to doing. And that was over long. I just want to also thank Jack Kellogg for helping to realize the film.
Thank you so much, Jill. I wanted to ask a question to Fierce Pussy directly, and that maybe all of us can sort of answer as well. But how has working as a collective allowed you to sort of create a sense of community, but also at the same time reflect the social consciousness of where we're at now? So, because in the film that you showed, it was a call from the future. What inspired that? And could you talk a little bit about sort of how that idea came together?
Can you hear us? Hi, Heather. Hi, everyone. Well, the transmission started in, we started receiving the transmissions in 2016. And there's been one every year since. And except for 2020, because there was a rupture. We had just come off the project at Greater New York, which was For the Record, which was very much about HIV and AIDS, the history of loss, mourning, how to grasp what that might is or has been, and try to bring it into the present so that anyone could maybe place themselves there. And we started thinking about, well, what instead of going down the road of, I don't know, what would you say, mourning, staying in that place, what if we turned it around and started looking at what could be? What's the possibility? What are our possibilities? What energy can we bring to that? And so that's how we started thinking about the project.
You know, like with the premise, if you can imagine it, it's possible.
Then it is.
If you can think of it, then it is.
Mm-hmm. So yeah, speaking from this idea that we are the free state of transplendency, that why not actually address from a kind of utopic state, and from that point of view, look back at now. So I think it's something that maybe certainly everyone who spoke today, that you feel inside yourself, you know inside yourself. I think from when you're a kid, you kind of know when something just feels like it's being done like the wrong way or a stupid way or a mean way. And you kind of know that you feel that things can be done a better way. And so we're like, let's tap into that.
How baffling it is, really, that it isn't that way. Yeah. How utterly trans-begoggling it is that it isn't that way. It isn't that, and that really is possible. And even though we speak from sort of a naive, asking, questioning voice, we know it's possible.
And there's also an acknowledgement, the beings who send the transmission, there are all these things they don't understand. We don't understand when we're transmitting from that place, but also there's an acknowledgement that they had had an overthrow at some point and made a decision to work in symbiosis with their planet and with the other beings. So there's an acknowledgement that change is also possible, and that these people who have progressed to a point that they don't even know what many of these words mean, but they do know that they had to make a decision to get there. And that feels like an important sort of turning point in how they express, how these beings are expressing themselves. They're not saying that they're perfect by some kind of birthright. They made a decision as a society to live away.
And they're also, the beings of the transplendency are also asking the beings of 2021 for some kind of communication, for some kind of, and obviously the beings on planet Earth from 2016 to 2021 have not communicated as of yet.
We do hear them when they're dancing, marching, moving bodies together. Mm-hmm. They are heard, and it's a growing hum. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Give us a sign.
Yes. Yeah, I thought it was very successful, and that the questions that you asked, the simplicity of them, really highlights the sort of insanity of the world that we're living in today. And Pamela, I wanted to ask you a little bit about Funeral Diva and the idea of, because you asked similar questions, you know, like in your work, what I find so successful is that it's like you're telling these little snippets of stories that go throughout history, all the way from Anne Frank to the now, to, you know, the HIV, like right at the beginning to the baby. It's a beautiful way of connecting all of the pain and trauma that we as a collective have experienced. And if we weren't touched by something specific in what you point out, it's something that someone we know has been touched by or we've read about. And so I'm curious if you could talk a little bit about this term trauma porn. The term trauma porn has been used to describe the proliferation of videos in which trans and Black people are being violently attacked and sometimes killed. And how do you think this affects the social consciousness? How does this witnessing these acts of violence over and over again affects you and your work?
Oh, that's a big question, but like trauma porn is certainly, I'm designing a course and it's like at the movies. I don't remember the whole thing, but I know, and it's like the rise of the new Blaxploitation, which is trauma porn, you know, and so I want to examine film, but like, you know, I'm somebody who's always worked with the historical, and I've, you know, been advocating forever that we talk about like slavery, that we tell more stories for Black people, more stories from women, more stories from queer people, more stories from transgender people, you know, the whole thing. And like, and now some of these stories are here and I'm horrified. I don't want to watch any of them. I feel like, you know, I just like, I enjoy on HBO, what is it, Lovecraft Country, you know, because I like science fiction. But other than that, I mean, Watchmen, all these shows, I just can't watch it. I love The Underground Railroad by Colson Whitehead. Like seeing it on Amazon Prime, I'm horrified. You know, I mean, it's just kind of like, it's like a mix of like, you know, The Color Purple, Roots, you know, and it's just degrading, you know, and it's one note. And I feel like you know, we've got to get past this, you know, here's the white people are the villains, and then, you know, the Black people are the victims, you know, and it's just kind of like, it's much more complicated than that. And the way that we're being asked to participate is as voyeurs, you know what I mean? And so rather than telling a human story where we all relate and we all can see ourselves, because all of those, you know, institutions and isms and, you know, colonial thought, it all belongs inside of us. You know what I mean? I mean, we all harbor it. And so the bottom line is that we can't go to these, like, you know, things and like say it's the other people, it's the other people, it's the other. It is not the other, it is us, you know? And so that's the problem, is that we have to stop being voyeurs, you know, and that we have to start telling human stories, you know? So I have a huge issue with like the trauma porn, and then, you know, and then like, and I don't understand in terms of social media, why some of this stuff is being passed around, you know? I mean, I can't, there's certain things I just can't watch, and I don't know why people keep posting it. So that's a whole other phenomenon, but it's supposed to be an advancement. We're supposed to be in an advancement, but we're not, you know? So that's why I'm calling it the rise of the new Blaxploitation, you know?
I love that. That's so true, except, the continued, like seeing the violence over and over again, is so numbing, and it's right. It's so painful.
And it's conditioning us. So it's conditioning us, like, so that basically we don't have any more reaction. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, being in that abusive, you know, violent relationship with the Trump administration, you know, and that every day, like, the acts were so outrageous that we lost all kinds of like normal sort of like responses. So we were literally being conditioned as victims. Like we couldn't, you know, like they changed whatever normal was for us. They changed whatever, you know, violence was for us, you know? And there was so much gaslighting and stuff. And so that we couldn't even like react because our pain threshold was constantly being, you know, moved up. Right. So even like with all of this like Blaxploitation stuff and like whatever, we're being conditioned, you know, and we're being conditioned not to respond. We're being conditioned to just, you know, I mean, it's like, I think about, I don't know, the opening of one of those shows, and there's like a Black man like being lit on fire and like running. And I'm like, I don't feel like any other people, they would just show that over and over and over and over again. You know, and like, and I couldn't get over it. You know what I mean? Or like, you know, I was rewatching The Wire, and like one of the cops, a white cop, had smashed one of the kids' eyes in, and for nothing, for absolutely no reason, you know? And it was never like, it was only addressed in like a 1 minute clip, you know, five episodes in. And it's like, he lost his eyesight. I can't get over that. You know what I mean? I'm not five episodes in. I'm still back where they smashed that kid's eye in and no one's addressed it. So we're just like being taught that like all these things are just normal, you know, to just keep going.
Right. I want to just mention, going from what you're saying, Pamela, to Jill in her piece where she avoided showing us the picture and the graphic of the scene and just instead describing it to us. I thought that was really a beautiful way of still keeping the heaviness of the moment without having to show and re-victimize the dead. I do want to, there was one question that I thought might be good for all of us to answer, whoever feels up to it. And the question is from Anne, and it's, I am curious how our panelists think we can hold space for our mourning, especially when the country, and especially in the last few weeks, seems to be in a hurry to open back up, including by willfully forgetting what we have just been through. We only have about 3 minutes to answer this, so does anybody have any thoughts?
I'm so grateful for the space, and thank you, Heather, for holding it with us after everybody's sharing today. And I'm thinking about fierce pussies, fierceness, and where Abdul-Aliy got us started, but these two words that FP gave us, trans, begoggling, right, and rupture. And I'm thinking about how much we've talked about death and where Pamela just took us, and the boarding school, right, outside of, in British Columbia and Tulsa. And these two kind of reckonings we're having with something that are not graves, that were not a caring, right, a saying goodbye, a holding, but were the very embodiment of the violences that we're talking about, and the different kinds of rupturing that we might initiate, as Abdul-Aliy reminded us at the start, and the different kinds of transmissions and transbegoggling that we might do together. I think to a presentation, there was weaving and collectivity, which was so crucial and so significant, right? It was never only at the level of individuality, and Pamela kept reminding us of that, even as she presenced so many beings, right? So many transmissions. And so I find myself, as we close, thinking about, there are many, many kinds of practices historically in the Americas among Indigenous peoples, but one throughout much of Mesoamerica and some of the Andes was through intention, not through mass slaughter and disavowal, but through intensive intentional care to break beautifully crafted ceramic ware as part of the interring of those that we love. And that's a different kind of rupture that is also problematically known now, in part because of grave robbing and the opening up of what was a loving, right, returning to the earth of people. And so I'm just holding that, like a different kind of rupture that we need, and that I think we're doing together today, and a different kinds of transbegoggling, which brings us back to the pleasure. And I was struck by the hearkening to dance and movement multiple times in the presentations today. So I'm thinking about those two words, transbegoggling and rupture.
And then Audre Lorde says, you know, at the end of Litany for Survival, we were never meant to survive. It is better to speak knowing that we were never meant to survive, right? Mm-hmm. And so the act of speaking, of languaging, you know, what we're going through, communing, you know, telling the truth.
Mm-hmm. We only get
soul screaming. I've unmuted us.
Can I say something? Yeah. Chris Percy, do you have something? Right.
Just wanted to say that if anybody wants to receive a transmission through snail mail, to please send their email to, or their snail mail address.
And if it's okay, I wanted to also add to something about mourning. I was so struck, Pamela, in Funeral Diva. I love that book, and you're reading today. But I was thinking about this concept, something we've talked about a lot, and other work we've done, is about this acknowledgement that loss doesn't stay in the past. Mm-hmm. Grief doesn't stay in the past, that it's an ongoing experience. When you lose someone, the friends that we lost during the early days of the AIDS crisis, we're still losing them now. We're missing them for their whole length of their lifetime. And that in this culture, there often isn't the kind of space to acknowledge grief as something that isn't encapsulated and has a time frame. And acknowledging the fact that grieving, mourning for those that you love, is a lifelong practice that keeps you in touch with who you love and what you love and what matters to you in life. And it's a practice it feels important to continue that practice rather than trying to get over it.
Thank you, beautiful. Abdul-Aliy, did you want to add something before we close?
Yeah, so many thoughts. The first thought is to Pamela's point about Blaxploitation, that, you know, we are living in a world, a cinematic world that was crafted by The Birth of a Nation, the film, right? And so Black people and Black people's archetypical representation on film is rooted in that racist kind of framework. And that is even when it comes to so-called real clips, right? Of like Black people being surveilled and tracked and murdered. The other thing that I wanted to say is that to this question of mourning and time, that, and Pato mentioned rupture, right? Because I'm in this moment in Philadelphia where a lot is being uncovered about a bombing that happened in 1985, Monday, May 13th, 1985, mm-hmm. a day after Mother's Day, which was May 12th that year, on Sunday, the city of Philadelphia bombed Black people in their home in West Philadelphia. The move bombing for no other reason than their politics, right? And their resistance. Five children lost their life, six adults. And the anthropologists who were tasked with trying to understand who was in the home when the bombing went off have held on to the remains for 36 years. When the families and loved ones of the people who died and were murdered that day in 1985 thought that their loved ones were buried in 1985 and 1986. Where one of the anthropologists holds up the bones of Tree Africa, who's 14 at the time of her death, and says that her bones are juicy on an online course for anthropology at Princeton University. So when we're talking about the mourning, right, this has opened up new wounds for the mothers of Africa and of Delisha Africa, another young person who died that day, who Penn Museum has held the remains without consent. And when we think of the violence, that violence continues and it's couched in academic rhetoric, right? Of restoring personhood. We held on to these remains because we wanted to restore personhood. And so we find ourselves living in this kind of surreal space where people are telling us that they have stolen our remains for our own benefit.
Oh, please.
And so I think that, you know, when it comes to time and mourning, that we have a reckoning. We have the business of tending to our dead that is incomplete. And I would lastly say, I was at a symposium about two years ago, because for years Penn has claimed that they did not have any connection to the institution of slavery. And someone named Shawande Mustakim, a PhD, wrote a book called Slavery at Sea. And in her research, she talked about the story of people coming through the Middle Passage, right? And being on a ship coming to the United States. And she uses the notes of the ship operator, for lack of, you know, the enslaver operating the ship. And there's a Black woman, an enslaved woman, who has been quarantined on the ship, because she's sick. And so he jots down in his journal, because she's cargo to him, about what can they do to get her healthy, right? And so they have doctors on board, practitioners who's trying to help her survive so that they can extract labor from her. And eventually they realize that she's so sick that she won't recover. And so the enslaver says in his journal, you know, that they bound her to a chair and they toss her overboard while she's alive. And his last entry about her is, that was a good chair. I'm so upset. I had to get rid of it. Where are her bones? They're probably dissolved at the bottom of the ocean. What was her name? We will never know. what was her story? Her story is untold. And there's a lot of reckoning that needs to happen.
Millions, you know, millions made the middle passage, you know. And, you know, having done a lot of research too at Cape Coast Castle in Ghana and being in South Africa, I mean, it's just sort of like, it's also like queer people, you know what I mean? In the sense that so many of our stories are untold, you know, in America up until the last two, you know, decades, last one really, you know, we had one story about slavery in one family, which was Roots. That's it. You know, that's it, you know, for the millions that made the passage. But I also wanted to say something about grief, that technology, and it's probably a whole other thing that, you know, another conversation that we could get into, but how technology has transformed our grieving patterns. And that basically, I mean, we're just getting like, you know, I still haven't recovered from Prince dying, Aretha, anybody, because basically it happens, you know, we get, I don't know, we're inundated for about 48 hours, maybe a week max, and then they're gone, you know, and then we never talk about it again, or, you know, there's some nostalgia. But so then, so the normal period or an acceptable period of grieving or mourning never happens, you know? So that's a whole other thing that happens, you know? That the technology has just completely disrupted all of our normal, you know, I mean, I hesitate to use the word normal, but you know.
there's no other word for it, because it's like the grief that continues on. It's a continual grief that's an ongoing wake. And that's what we were able to have a little bit tonight, to mention those stories that Abdul-Aliy told us and Pamela mentioned, and to never forget, you know, these people that came before us, and the people like also Zoe mentioned that, you know, as long as they're in our memory, they're going to continue living on. So thank you so much. We've come to the end of our panel discussion. It went by so fast, but this was such a gift to have you all in one room together. I would just like to, in closing, thank you, the audience, for being here and listening to us and holding space for us. And I'd like to thank Jill and Jessica and Anne for curating this wonderful panel tonight. I'd like to thank Fierce Pussy, Pamela Sneed, and What Would an HIV Doula Do?, as well as the Ford Foundation and Lisa Kim for making this possible. Chapter 5, Melancholy as Medium. Everybody have a wonderful night. Oh, I wanted to say also, yes, you can order these by Pamela's book, Funeral Diva. Put your email, or not your email, your mailing address into the, I think email us your mailing address and we'll mail you one of these transmissions from Fierce Pussy. Okay. Are you, okay, it tells you there. If you'd like to receive a copy of Transmission by Fierce Pussy, please provide your mailing address using the link in the chat. And thank you so much for coming tonight.
All right. Jill, thank you, Heather. Good job.
Thank you,
Heather. Thank you, Heather. And thank you all so much. Not moving on. Melancholy is medium. Melancholy is power. For the grief that we still have to not let go. So thank you. Thank you all so much, really profoundly. Gorgeous all.
Do we know when this is going up online, the video?
In America.
Yes, it is available online. There should be a link for everybody who RSVP'd. You will receive a link, and there will be a link on the website as well.